Piano Jazz is made possible by the National Endowment for the Arts, the Joseph Drown Foundation, the Baldwin Piano Company, Borders Books and Music, and NPR. Hi, I'm Marian McPartland. My guest today on Piano Jazz is pianist, educator, and composer Ellis Marsalis. And he's really the premier jazz pianist of New Orleans, and he's the father of a generation of contemporary jazz musicians, including his sons, Winton, Branford, Delphio, and Jason. And man, you've got a lot to answer for. You really have. How are you, Ellis?
Fine, thank you. It's been since 1988 when I did your show.
Was that when it was?
It was. Yeah, I was living in Richmond, Virginia then.
That's right. You know, there was so many things. Well, things have got a lot different since then, because at that time, I think Delphio was at Berkeley.
Right.
And Winton was probably, I don't know if he was in New York yet.
Yeah, he was in New York. He went to New York in 79.
And Jason was at home.
Right.
And
in elementary school.
My goodness. But it's just like a minute, you know. Just
That's
like
right.
a minute. And now, when I think what they're all doing, and Delphio, as a matter of fact, he produced that album of yours that I like so much that has Syndrome, didn't he? Didn't he?
Yes, he
that?
Did.
Well, he must have been, like, must have been one of his first times trying that, wasn't it? Or was it?
It's hard to say because, you know, Delphio has been trying to record since he was in high school.
Really?
With the little cheap equipment that I had at the house.
Really?
And when he went to Berkeley, he sort of just continued while he was studying audio engineering.
Well, he wound up being that and being a trombone player, didn't he?
Right.
It's so fascinating. I mean, you and all these kids, and you must be so proud of them when I think what they're doing. How did that all happen? You must have been a heck of a great father and mother, you and Dolores.
I have no real idea about how it happened. I know my wife was the glue that kept all of us together. But for that many people in one family to become musically endowed, there must have been some kind of spiritual intervention in that, because my ego is not big enough to think that I could really have done that.
Well, maybe it got bigger now when you see what they're all doing. Either that or you got more humble. I don't know.
Well, I hope it's humility. I hope.
Well, but meanwhile, I mean, I'm never sure what comes first with you, being a jazz pianist or being an educator.
Well, in my case, it was a decision that I didn't really have to make as a separate entity, because with rare exception, I was hired at the New Orleans Center for Creative Arts to bring a jazz presence to that program. So I was rather fortunate that the hat that I was wearing for the teacher was the same hat that I wore on the bandstand.
Boy, that turned out to be great, didn't it?
Yes.
That's amazing. Well, you know, I just want to question you and quiz you and ask you all kinds of things, but the thing I'm really dying to hear is to hear you play something. And back to that same record that you made with Delphio producing it, I think it's called Syndrome.
Yes.
And that's a tune that you played on the record.
Yeah, it's a piece. It's something that evolved into a piece. In the beginning, it was an exercise that I used with one of the guitar students, where I would just play. And I would have them to improvise on that, just on those changes. So I was fooling around with it, you know, playing it in different rhythms, and I heard this melody in my head against these changes. And eventually, I started to use that melody with those chord changes. And I added another section to it just as a way of sort of introducing it.
Well, it evolved into a beautiful tune.
And it did.
I love that tune. Why did you call it Syndrome?
You know, I have no particular rhyme or reason as to why I name tunes what I call them.
I thought maybe it had some sort of significance, like a, you know, like a, you know, like a something syndrome.
That's sort of like an illness. I remember.
Well, yeah. I wouldn't. If that's a very nice illness to have, I must say. Tunism. Whatever you call it, it's beautiful. Tell me more about the school. You know, did your kids go to the performing arts school that you were teaching
yeah,
at?
Yeah, Branford, Winton, Delphio, and Jason went to the New Orleans Center for Creative Arts. However, Jason went during the time when I was not on the faculty. Jason went when we came back from Richmond, Virginia in 89, he started then, if not then, sometime in the 90s. So Branford, Winton, and Delphia were at the Center for Creative Arts during the time I was teaching there.
Well, were you teaching there when I played there and met them all as kids? That was one of the great experiences of my life.
Well, those were all NOCA kids, as we call them.
Initials.
N-O-C-C-A.
What was that for?
The New Orleans Center for Creative Arts.
Oh, because I'm thinking to myself, I'm doing this concert and somebody says, you've got to hear these kids play, or something like that. And, you know, I'm thinking, oh, do I? Okay. You know, and I was floored by the way they sounded. I mean, they were so terrific. I'm so proud of that picture I have of them with me on piano.
Yeah, that band at the time, the students there, Branford, Donald Harrison, Winton, Tony Dillon was the drummer.
Right.
And there was an electric bass player, Anthony Hamilton.
Well, it turned out to be a very exciting event. And I think maybe that's about the time I met you when you were...
Right. I was at the Hyatt Regency.
You were at the Hyatt playing in the atrium.
Right.
Because, I mean, that's what you did a lot in those days, wasn't it?
Mm-hmm.
As well as teaching at the school. You would had a gig somewhere. But anyway, you're still there, I guess, at the school, aren't you?
No, I left when I went up to Richmond, Virginia in 86. And when I came back to New Orleans, I came back to begin my tenure at the University of New Orleans, which is where I am now.
But you're an active, busy guy and playing all over the place, recording all over the place. And you've got this lovely Duke album, Duke Ellington record, which we'll hear about sooner or later.
Yes.
But meanwhile, another tune. I'd love to hear something, some standard tune that you like.
Yeah, I used to hear, I heard Al Tatum do this once. And since I always knew that there was no way that I could ever play like that, I would sometimes attempt to have my own renditions of pieces that I heard Art play. This is I Cover the Waterfront.
Oh, great.
Thank you.
Well, I would say that was sort of Tatum-esque.
Yeah, slightly Tatum-esque.
Well, I guess I'm also one of those people that listened to Art Tatum when I was in England, and I even went so far as to buy a book of transcriptions of his, and I looked at that thing, and I was just helpless. I mean, I threw it away.
I did the same thing.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Well, the one thing I learned to play sort of a little bit of was that arrangement he had of Humoresque, you know, and it was in F sharp. And that was so nice, and he made it swing, and, you know, and I thought, well, I learned to play that just a little bit, but as soon as he got into any of those runs, man, I... Mm-hmm. But did you meet him?
No, I never did. He was on a tour that was coming to New Orleans. That was a part of... the tour was sort of led by the Kenton Band, and they were coming into New Orleans. And when the tour got here, he was not on it. And I asked one of the clarinet players, I think it was Jimmy Giuffre, about Art. And he said, well, Art got sick, and he got off the tour maybe a week before they got to New Orleans. And he was telling me the story. He said one time, he said they had about 2 or 3 days off. And he said Tatum liked to drink beer. And they went in the auditorium, and somebody got 2 or 3 cases of beer, and Art sat at the piano and drank beer and played for 12 straight hours.
I can believe it. You know, I probably got to go to one of the very last speakeasy-type places with Art and Jimmy McPartland, and we were listening to him in Cleveland in a club called Lindsay's Sky Bar, and after the job, he took us to this place. And, you know, and you're in the house walking up into a regular street and up this dark flight of stairs, and the door opens, and, man, they've got jukeboxes and the people drinking and the piano is going. And he did that same thing. Like, he sat there and played till daylight and drinking beer, doing the exact same thing. But, mm-hmm. I mean, that's one of my great experiences of my life. So... Anyway, but I mean, that's typical that he'd sit and drink beer and play piano for 12 hours, so he didn't make the tour to New Orleans.
No, in fact, he died not too long after that, so I never got to hear him.
That's a shame. That's a shame. There's just been nobody like him. Incredible guy. Well, more music in a minute or two, but first I should let our listeners know my guest is Ellis Marsalis. I'm Marian McPartland, and this is Piano Jazz, made possible in part by a grant from the National Endowment for the Arts. Well, I would just love to do a duet with you. What do you think we could do?
Well, how about an old Fats Waller piece, Honeysuckle Rose?
I'd love to do that. Okay. Well, you start it and I'll sort of fit in somewhere. Thank you. Gee, I'm so glad we had an extensive rehearsal of that beforehand.
Right, right. It's nothing like those long rehearsals to get everything exactly the way we want it.
You know, I love that groovy tempo. I mean, not everybody, I think, can set. A lot depends on where you put it in the groove, doesn't it?
That's true. It is.
You know, you could do that thing just a hair faster or a hair slower, and it wouldn't lie right like it did.
That's right.
So how can you teach people that, or can you? Just by doing?
It's not. I don't think it's a case of teaching people that. You expose them to people who do what it is that you want them to do so that they can hear what it sounds like. To replicate that means that you have to put together the right combination of people so that that chemistry is there. You know, it's like a football team or any other kind of team. When the chemistry is there, you can take players who are like not stars and they just win, like the Yankees. You know, they just win because everybody can play and the chemistry is good with the team. And I think it's the same thing, especially in a rhythm section. You know, you get a piano, bass, and drums, and the chemistry is right.
Well, and there's has to be an awful lot of listening.
Definitely. That is one of the things that I think doesn't occur enough, especially in the process of teaching younger people. There's just not enough time spent listening because for some reason, somebody somewhere thought that the definition of learning and understanding music was to be able to read it. So consequently, developing one's ears took a back seat.
It's funny, and with me, it was the other way around. I wish I could read better, but I've always played by ear.
Well, think how many reading musicians don't work.
I never thought about that. Never. That's something to think about. But anyway, thank God we're working. But it's a funny thing, and it's like a certain sensitivity. I remember years ago having a drummer, and I was kind of wimpy. I found it hard to tell somebody, you know, that they were too loud. And he was just too loud. And finally I did tell him, and his answer was, well, I can't really hear the piano, he said. Like, I should play louder. So I said, well, why don't you try playing softer? So he did. But, boy, drummers, well, you've got one in your family. I'll bet he doesn't play too loud.
Well, he's a student of the music, and I think he also bears out what we were talking about in terms of listening a lot. He listens a lot to all different kinds of music and understands one of the major things that drummers, and especially drummers, need to understand is that when you're playing, you have to play the room.
Play the room?
The room that you're in.
I never thought of that before.
Yeah, you can play in a room in which the reverberation is extremely sensitive. And if you play as though you are in another space where there's a lot of carpet on the floor, there's a complete difference.
That's true.
You have to learn to play the room. And that's another thing. You can't necessarily teach that, but you make people aware. So that when they are in a certain situation and that things might not be going very well, then that's something that they can think about and say, well, maybe I'm not playing appropriate for the room that I'm in.
It's funny. And actually, when you play in a room with a carpet, that's terrible for a piano, isn't it? Or that deadens the piano.
Well, for any of the instruments, because it soaks up all the sound.
Well, we could really get into something here, but you know what?
Yeah, we're getting closer and closer into physics.
Yeah, and I don't want to go there.
Neither do I.
I'm too dumb. But what I'd like to do is let our listeners know my guest is Ellis Marsalis. I'm Marian McPartland, and this is Piano Jazz, which is made possible in part by the Baldwin Piano Company, manufacturers of the pianos heard on Piano Jazz. 1-800-876-2976. I would like to do another duet because I thought the first one was really nice and it's had that good tempo. And obviously you know how to pick the right tempos. So maybe you could pick another tune.
Yes. How about another oldie, the Limehouse Blues?
Now that is old, and I think it was written by an English person. But I can't think who. Do you know anything about that tune?
No,
what's the history of it?
I don't know. It's always been one of the songs that the trad bands here in New Orleans played.
Oh, really?
Yeah, but I don't know much about the history of it.
Well, did you ever play with one of the trad bands?
Yeah, I played with the Storyville Jazz Band, which with Teddy Riley, the French Brothers, Bob and George French. Fred Lonzo. Well, that was mostly what we did. You know, songs like Bourbon Street Parade and Sensation Rag and the long list of.
I can play all those tunes.
Mm-hmm.
Ostrich Walk. oh, God. A million of them. But I think they're fun to play. I mean, I don't think I'd want to do it all my life, but there's a lot of fun in those tunes and the way the horns have to blend a certain way. It's
if you get the right combination of musicians, it can really be great.
Yeah, because it's really not as easy. I think everybody thinks you just, you know, go.
Oh, that's polkas.
That's what?
That's a polka.
Oh, yeah. Now, that's something altogether. We don't want to talk about that.
Yeah.
Well, anyway, let's have a go at Limehouse Blues. Thank you.
That was fun.
It was fun. And I think, where's he going to go on the ending? You know. But I guess those are sort of typical endings to those tunes, aren't they? That's a fun tune to play. I'm trying to think. I keep thinking, I'm sure it's from a play or something. Anyway, you've made a lot of recordings, and your latest one of tunes by Duke Ellington, that is really nice. I mean, I don't think we can continue the show without you doing something from that CD. I would love to hear one.
Yeah, the one that probably gave me the biggest problem was the Mooch. And it was not so much that it was a difficult piece, it's just to try and capture the feel that Duke's band had playing the Mooch, which is virtually impossible.
I was going to say, that's pretty hard to do. Because...
No, it's impossible, you know, for a lot of different reasons. Not only that this is a solo piano listening to a whole band play, but I decided I'd tackle it anyway. So this is the results of my efforts. Thank you.
Well, I think you did a remarkable job of capturing the Duke Ellington feeling, even though it was with a big band. I mean, and that's a wonderful tune. For some reason, not too many people play it. Maybe it's because it's a little sort of, it's not difficult to play, but it's an unusual tune, isn't it?
Right.
But anyway, it's time to let you know that my guest is Ellis Marsalis. I'm Marian McPartland, and this is Piano Jazz, which is made possible in part by Borders Books and Music, celebrating the arts by supporting cultural programming on NPR, 1-800-644-7733. No, I really think it would be nice to hear something else from that Duke Ellington CD. And you did some, it was a nice selection of tunes. What one do you think you'd like to do?
How about Melancholia? That's a song that I heard. Winton recorded it, and I listened to it, and I started to play it more and more because of its melodic content. And I just sort of fell in love with that.
It's a very kind of a reflective, not altogether sad, but kind of a, yet a moody piece, isn't it? But such a nice melody. And Duke, he always has these little, it doesn't always go where you expect it to go.
It never goes where you expect it to go.
So you have to have that little extra thought in your brain. No, it's not going to go over there. It's going to go over here. You know, no, I'd love to hear you play that because actually not too many people play it, so I'd love to hear you do it.
Good.
Okay.
Be glad to.
Okay. Thank you. Gee, I'm so glad you picked that tune because it's not only is it a beautiful song, but it's sort of underplayed. More people should do it. Maybe now Winton and you have both recorded it. Maybe more people will be aware of it.
It's unusual in a way in its structure. When I say unusual, what I mean is that it doesn't necessarily invite improvisation, you know?
No, it doesn't. That is true.
And which is fine with me.
I mean, the thing doesn't have to be improvised,
right.
Is it, necessarily?
I remember once I was doing a solo performance, and I did Dolphin Dance. It's a Herbie Hancock song.
Yes, sure.
And I played the song, and I didn't improvise on it. So at the end of the show, a guy asked me, he said, why didn't you solo on Dolphin Dance? I said, I didn't want to solo on it. I just wanted to play the song because I thought it was a beautiful melody.
Well, actually, that in itself is improvisation, you choosing not to do that.
Right.
That was the your take on the tune. And it is a beautiful tune. But anyway, you know, this is ridiculous. We've been sitting here and talking and playing, and time is almost gone. It's gone very fast for me because you've made some erudite remarks and told me a few things that are going on. What's coming up new and different for you? Anything new?
Well, I'm trying to make up my mind to write more. That is music. I actually write and arrange because I'm the director of the jazz orchestra at University of New Orleans, but I've never really written anything for it. I've just usually rehearsed it and worked with trying to get a good band sound and that kind of stuff. But I'm thinking now, I have a performance coming up, and at this performance, it's a yearly performance, and it's just called Marsalis Presents, whatever it is that I decide to do. And I'm thinking that I would really like to do some arrangements for that jazz orchestra and feature me with them.
Well, you said it now. You're going to have to do it.
Well, yeah, that's usually what happens.
Yeah, isn't
you know,
it?
You deal with, you know, I need deadlines.
Well, that's what Duke said. I don't need time. I need a deadline.
Right.
I'm sure you'll get it together.
Well, if I do and I manage to make a tape of it, I'll send you a tape.
And I'd love to have it. But meanwhile, thanks for coming and making such a nice time here for me. I've enjoyed it. And what'll we do to close out with? You've got some brilliant ideas.
Yeah, let's do that blues that we were working on, you know, the Eminem blues.
That we were working on.
Right.
Ha, ha, ha.
The Marsalis, Marsalis blues,
well,
the Eminem blues.
Let's work on it now. Thank you. Boy, if that wasn't a real Count Basie tempo, I don't know what was.
Definitely.
That was wonderful, Ellis. My guest today on Piano Jazz has been Ellis Marsalis. I'm Marian McPartland, inviting you to join me again next week. This Piano Jazz was recorded at the studios of the College of Music at Loyola University in New Orleans and is a production of South Carolina Educational Radio. The producer is Sherry Hutchinson, recording engineer is Brooke Sutton, mastering engineer is David Mitchell, production manager is Audrey Shiflett, executive producer is Tom Clark. Special thanks to Reed Wick and Dean Edward Cavett of the College of Music at Loyola University, New Orleans. Major support for Piano Jazz comes from the Wallace Reader's Digest Funds, seeking to enrich community life through support of education, the arts and culture, and from the Joseph Drown Foundation. Additional support comes from the Friends of Piano Jazz, NPR stations, Saab introducing the new performance lineup, the 9-5 Aero, and the 9-3 Viggen. Information available at saabusa.com and 1-800-SAAB-USA. And Rockefeller Brothers Fund, providing support for NPR cultural programming through a Charles E. Culpepper Endowment Grant. If you would like to email us, our address is pj@scetv.org. That's pj@scetv.org. And please include your mailing address. You can visit our website at www.pianojazz.org. That's www.pianojazz.org. This is NPR, National Public Radio.